Good evening and welcome to the General Society of Mechanics and Tradesmen. My name is Victoria Dangle and I'm the Executive Director of the General Society. Again, I welcome you. The program tonight is supported in part by public funds from the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs in partnership with the City Council, as well as from the generous support of the McQuesten Companies, Peter Pinoia Architects, and Bauer and Dean Publishers, and the Friends of the Artisan Lecture Series. For those of you not familiar with our organization, the General Society was founded in 1785 by 22 tradesmen. At that initial meeting, there were people, there were carpenters, saddlers, tailors, coachmakers, blacksmiths, and silversmiths, among others. The mission of the Artisan Lecture Series is to promote the work and art of skilled craftsmen to assist in ensuring their unique knowledge is understood and carried forth for generations to come. The series is curated by General Society member Camille Wiart. And I would like to ask Camille to please introduce our speaker for the evening. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Victoria. Good evening, ladies and wonderful to have you all here tonight. This is actually the last artisan lecture of the series. The next series will start in the fall. And if you would like to receive announcements about the next master artisans that we feature, feel free to either leave your business card with Victoria or someone from the General Society or myself. We'd be more than happy to add you on the list. This is our first time featuring, as guest speaker, a master perfume producer. François Damide has worked for over 20 years in the fashion industry in the States, most notably for Solstiss, a leading French lace artisan maker. 5 years ago, he converted to beauty and founded his company, Crafting Beauty, which produces small runs and exclusive products of fragrances, oils, and more. And additionally, François is on the committee of numerous, is involved in numerous committees in New York and was just informed me he was recently elected president of the committee of the High School of Fashion Industries, which, if you know, this high school is the only high school dedicated to fashion in the U.S. that is located here in our beloved city. So without further ado, please join me for a warm welcome to François.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Camille. Thank you, the General Society. I'm very happy. This is a very nice turnaround. As you know, your donation is definitely very welcome because this is a non-profit and the money raised is to maintain this lovely institution. And when you look at it, it's absolutely unbelievable. It was created 9 years after the United States of America. So that's a long time ago. Anyway, so thank you for the presentation. So briefly, the first question you might have is how did I come from lace to perfume? I mean, what's the transition? So briefly, I came from a small city in northern France where they manufacture lace, and my dream was to come in America. So I begged my bosses at the time to move me to the US. So I came to the US in September 86 to open their US offices. From there, you know, business grew, and 20 years after, I decided to part ways in a very amicable way, and just to do something else. I realized that in New York, the sky is the limit. This is America, after all, and I wanted to do other things. So I was hired to open the offices of another French company from Grasse. And as you know, Grasse is the world capital of fragrance. So I opened that company, Artes, and I always love fragrance. And I thought this will be an opportunity. They accept the fact that I had absolutely no experience, but I was ready for the challenge and themselves. So after 2.5 years where business start to take off, unfortunately, that company went out of business. So I was let go. That was the first time I was let go in my life and the last time. And hopefully, I'm not going to fire myself. So at that point, I was thinking, what am I going to do? I was not really very keen in going back into fashion. I had too little experience to get hired by a big fragrance company. So I'm thinking I'm going to create my own company. And what will I do? Well, from the fashion, when I was really catering to the fashion designer, creating lace and silk for American designers, I'm thinking, why don't I create perfume for American designers? So that was the idea behind Crafting Beauty. So I'm going to explain you what Crafting Beauty does. So Paris, New York, yes, because it's made in France, and I think it's important today as a luxury company to still have a made in France label. Thank God the French are known for perfume, so it does help. So yes, Crafting Beauty opens a Paris office not long ago. Good evening, Ariane. Thank you for coming. So, as I said, my goal was really to develop fragrances for fashion houses. So how can a fashion house launch its own fragrance? So you might think, oh, it's very easy. You know, you have Yves Saint Laurent. You know, you have Yves Saint Laurent is with L'Oréal. You have, you have all these big names that are tied with L'Oréal. But if you are a smaller designer, okay, a label that, let's say, you are a fashion designer and you have your own label, you have your own line, you have been around for the past 10 years, you do $10 million, you have 4 stores, what do? If you are not known, it's going to be extremely difficult for you to have a L'Oréal or an Estée Lauder, just to give example, to knock at your door. So I have the solution. So what we do is that I'm giving the opportunity for a small fashion house to create, develop, and distribute under their own channel of distribution their own fragrance. So that's what it is. So, but really, it's truly a custom-made perfume. So it works in 5 steps. First, we're going to work on the product brief, then on the product design, then fragrance development with the master perfumer at MAN. I'm going to talk a little further about that after. Project rendering and prototype, timing, budget, and income projection. The brief. So what is the brief? The brief is basically the concept. So you are a fashion designer. You know what you are doing, meaning either you are doing evening wear, you are doing bridal, you are doing contemporary, you are doing separate. We have designers here, actually, here tonight. Thank you, Doris. I see Doris, I see George. So a fashion designer know to what is their consumer, what is their customer. So it works the same with perfume. Either you are targeting a woman, you know, rather a woman between, I will say, 30 to 50, or you are targeting a teenage girl, or you are targeting a man, or you are a luxury, or you are a rather mass. So that's what we need to put together for the perfume. So the story behind, also the designer, what inspires you? Do you have fond memories of your first approach in perfume? That's how it works. So I'm going to sit down with the designer to really try to connect the designer, the woman or the man behind the brand, into the scent, into the product by itself. So again, it could be, oh, I will never forget, my mother was wearing Chanel No. 5. You know, it's very fond memory, and she was very elegant, so I want something like that. Now, style and positioning, I mentioned that earlier. Targeted demography, what are we talking? Again, teenage girl, older woman, whatever it is. Product category, what do you want? Do you want an eau de parfum, meaning you want a higher concentration? Do you want a body lotion? Do you want a soap? Do you want ambient spray? It's also important in the development. Now, the type. Are we talking a spray, a roll-on, a splash? That's also the type of question that we need to lay down in order to put together the project. Fragrance, would you like one scent that will be your signature scent, or would you like a collection? As you know, lately there have been lots of launch of collection, rather 3, 5, 6, 7 scents. Everybody has in mind l'Artisan Perfumer because they have a huge collection, or Annick Goutal. You know, you can do that, of course. You know, again, depending on the budget you have, of course, and the effect you want to have into the market and into the business. Long-term planning. Do you want this to be a limited edition? Do you want to launch it only for the holiday season? Or you really would like to build your collection on a long-term basis? And then distribution. Will you sell it via your own store? Or will you sell it first via your own store and then maybe have an exclusive distribution with, let's say, a department store such as Bloomingdale's or Nordstrom? Or you want to go internationally? This is also very important in terms of the costing. So far, everything is understood. I'm not too fast. Okay. Very good. Now, part two. Packaging design. There's two types of packaging. There's what we call the primary pack. What is the primary pack? The primary pack is everything that touches the scent, the juice, what we call the juice in the business. So it's the barrel, the pump, and the cap. So what we'll do first is that you're going to come to my showroom. We're going to look at hundreds and hundreds of barrels. And you're going to tell me which one you like. And then we're going to look at the decor. Let's say you are a fashion designer that loves lace, just to think about lace, you know. So let's say you want to decor the barrel with some lace. So that's, we're going to decor it with lace. Then we're going to talk about the cap and pumps. So the cap and pumps also will be, we will choose from, or we can custom create, of course, the cap and pumps. There's really endless of possibilities. If you walk through the perfume department of a department stores, if you look at it in a very technical way, you will realize actually that there's lots of similarities in terms of style, in terms of texture, in terms of material used in the perfume. It's very interesting. Anyway, but I advise you to do this if you want to go to a more technical aspect. The second part is called the secondary packaging, which is basically the box. The box is very important. Why? Because this is the first product that you will see before smelling the perfume. The box is really the message that will translate your brand that you want to convey. So again, you are a very feminine designer, or you are a more contemporary, modern, edgy, the finish and the style of the box will be extremely important. I just took two examples at what I produce. Here we have Midnight Promise, where the customer wanted something, obviously, to be in sync with the promise of midnight. And he wanted something very elegant. The name of the brand is called Bellegant, so obviously it's in the name. And here we have on the right side a brand that has a very Eastern Europe vibe, and they really wanted to have that style. Also, you have to understand, when my mission is that there's no conflict of interest with what the customer wish for. The same way I was trained when I was selling and creating lace design and silk print to designer. I am not the person that will tell the designer, like we used to, I have my whole team sitting here. When you sit down with the Donna Karan, and we did sit down with Donna Karan, and God knows, you know, we are dealing with big egos. I'm not saying her personally, but, you know, when you deal with a Calvin, with a Donna, with a Marc Jacobs, with a Michael Kors, who was a sweetheart, actually, you are not sitting down with those people where their label is on the garment. You are not telling them what to do and what to buy and what are the trends. You are then to listen to them and to shut up, basically. And then if they ask you a question, you answer. But you do not tell them, well, you should take that navy blue because it's really cool for this season. No, you don't do that. So I apply to the same method in the fragrance. So I'm really executing the wish of the customer. I'm here to guide if they ask me a question, but again, you know, I want them to feel, it's more than to feel, I really am here to give them what they want. So if they want a perfume that is, that I, for instance, a very high concentration of fragrance, and I personally feel it's a little too strong, if they ask me what I think, I will tell them, well, I feel it's a little too strong and it might be a little bit overwhelming for their customer. But if they want to do this, we'll do this. Fragrance development. So we're going to talk a little further with the fragrance development. But Crafting Beauty works mainly with the House of Man. The House of Man is a French fragrance house. It's actually the biggest fragrance house. They are based in southern France, next to Grasse. And I work with them. We really have a very good collaborating relationship. So we are able to access, you know, their laboratories. And I will introduce Ralf later on, and he will speak a little more about the actual creation of the fragrance. So I'm going to skip that slide, but we will go back to that. When the fragrance is finalized, the packaging is finalized, the bottle is finalized, the decor and the cap, what we'll do is that my mission is, of course, to give a rendering of the finished product to the customer before we actually launch the production. My minimum order is 1,000 units, which might sound like a lot, but when you know the industry standard, it's actually nothing. It's been lots of homework, building relationship with all my suppliers and contractors in France, which I really selected, you know, going up north and south and east-west in France to really build that network. So thanks to that, I was able to have them willing to produce 1,000 units. Before we launch the actual, you know, production, my team do a prototype, which is basically the mock-up, the best rendering of the finished product to 90%, because it's never perfect until the product is done. But at least it can give a final product to the customer, so they can feel, smell, hold it in their hands, weigh it, and they can really see what will be the actual product. And also they can start the advertising, the photography, the model, and all the marketing material they can start to before we launch the production. Timing, budget, and income projection. In the beginning I didn't do that, but now I'm really giving this because sometimes they are overwhelmed by the cost, but of course there is an investment, of course it's not free, but I really want to show them that they can really make money by launching their own perfume. So the timing, first of all, it's like a baby, it's could be longer than a baby, but it's between 9 months to a year, and it's difficult to shrink that period. Because there's lots of testing involved, there's lots of compatibility tests in terms of the cap with the juice, in terms of the decor with the juice, because believe it or not, but the scent by itself can have a reaction on the decor, depending on the ingredient that you use. The seal also can have a reaction, so you want to make sure that it doesn't leak. So the timing, it's difficult to narrow this down. The budget. Controlling the destiny of a brand requires an upfront investment. When I say destiny, the customer, the designer, will be the owner of its inventory. which is extremely, extremely important, because you want to make sure, as your, if it's your label, that you know who will sell your product, and you want to make sure that this product will not be diverted or sold to unwanted hands. So it's extremely important. I'm sure sometime you let's say you buy L'Oreal or an Armani or you know, whatever, you buy it and you go to Macy's or Bloomingdale's and you will pay, let's say, $95 for the product. And then you discover that the same product is on sale to a local store, like it's not very official, you know, and you find it at $30 and you wonder, what is it? Is it the real thing? I just pay $90 for the same product. And it's very important, because when you are dealing with those huge volume, unfortunately, sometimes part of those shipment ends up in the wrong hands. And it's called the gray market, the diverters. And those people are here to buy those brands at a good price with big quantity. And then you end up, you discover that your product is on sale there. So it works against you, obviously, and against the brand that you have been building. So it's very important that when you do it in-house, when you invest, that at least you control it. Actually, I signed a contract with the brand to confirm also that even myself, I am not manufacturing extra that I might sell on the side. I commit to show that to people, because it's very important. Let's say I manufacture one product that is becoming very hot item. Of course, the customer wants to make sure that I don't have, 1,000 pieces in my closet that I can make extra money. No, you have to be extremely, extremely diligent and extremely strict. And for that, it's important. So, in terms of budget, there is no preset budget. I put together over there some product that I did. Some of those products has leads that are gold plated. Just the lead by itself on the candle, so have a look, don't steal it. Just the lead like itself, you know, is already $15. So the customer wanted an ultra luxurious product, she wanted real gold, we did it. So really, sky is the limit. Okay? But let's say, as I'm just taking an average here. So let's say the creation of the product, including the creation of the scent, the tooling, the prototyping is about $15,000, which is a one-time fee, which you have to pay, like when you create your own clothes, your sample, you know, that's how it works. Then the unit cost is about $40, so the total investment is $55,000. Okay? Your income projection, knowing it's going to be your product that you will sell exclusively in your store. Obviously, that it's, if I may say, it's a little bit of your baby, so you are very proud and you know every single aspect of the making of the product. You will not want to downgrade the product. So you will automatically or naturally, you will sell it to a certain price point. And again, if a customer advises me, I will always tell them, go at least from 145 and up. So at that price point, you are reaching a level that is called the niche business, which I'm sure you've heard, which is really very much in trend lately, because in the niche fragrance, it's basically the crafted fragrance, it's the couture, it's the artisanal fragrance, and they are difficult to find, and it's really a trend lately, because unfortunately we have been overwhelmed with so many new products at department stores that people question the quality, and they feel it's becoming more a marketing tool rather than a concentration on really truly a product. So $175 for a single product, I think it's nice. So the estimated sales will be $175, obviously, and the product will be sold out within 3 months. So the gross margin will be $120,000. So within 3 months, if the customer, of course, do their product and train the customer, the store's team, and of course, you know, do whatever they are supposed to do to promote it, they can do a very nice return on investment. Very, very nice return on investment. And for the reorders, because the costing is no longer 15, it's 135. So it's really, not only it's a fantastic vehicle to make the brand more prestigious, to make the brand more unique, and you are part of the big names of the fashion industry. Everybody has in mind, you know, Coco Chanel, you know, introducing Chanel number 5. I mean, it's really fantastic for a fashion brand to have its own fragrance. So these are some of the creation. Enchanted Forest Eau de Parfum by Vagabond Prince. Retail price at $200. It was launched in 2012. This is another product from for the brands of Vagabond Prince. Still this Eastern Europe file, you know, which is what they wanted. This is another one. This was launched last year. And this was created by a master perfumer by the name of Bertrand Duchaufour. Bertrand Duchaufour is the nose behind most of l'artisan parfumeur product. Here we have another independent brand who created two scents, two products, Saint-Barthélemy and Marrakech, based on his traveling. This is a famous fashion photographer. And it was launched at Henri Bendel, New York, in 2001. The product is here, if you want to smell it. Midnight Promise, retail price at $105, so not too expensive, but again, the brand wanted to make the product, you know, affordable, so that was his choice. And, I'm sorry, here you see we did it the custom cap. You can see the butterfly, it's actually the double B of Belogance. So that's what we did for him. So the barrel is actually a standard barrel, Italian barrel, with a heavy base, so it's a heavy barrel. And custom decor, of course, but the cap has been specifically created for the brand. Here we have Lode Weitzmann. Alors, this was an interesting, this was a limited edition that the Weitzmann University in Israel wanted to create a fragrance, so we did 500 units for a big event they had in New York that they gave away as a goodie. So I thought it was very unique. This was created by Christophe Laudamiel, another master perfumer, independent, and Christophe is the nose behind Abercrombie & Fitch and Estée Lauder and some Ralph Lauren fragrance. Another creation in terms of scent by Christophe Laudamiel, it's a candle. It's called L'Olivier. L'Olivier is a florist in Uptown, in the city. It's one of the top florist designer, and he's the florist that supply the Carlyle Hotel and Daniel Restaurant, and he's launching a line of candles, so we did it. I do soap as well. So this was a store called New London Pharmacy that wanted to launch his own soap. So we did it. Fantastic soap, actually. I have to buy it now to use it. It's I love it. It's 100% natural, vegan. It's a fantastic product. And now we're going to talk about L'Organic Beauté. L'Organic Beauté is a very special. Unfortunately, the founder of L'Organic could not be here tonight, but this is, I will say, the perfect collaboration that Crafting Beauty had with the House of Man and with Ralph. So I'm going to welcome Ralph, who is with us tonight. Ralf Schwieger, master perfumer at Man. Thank you, Ralph, for coming.
Yeah,
So briefly, so this lady came to my office about 2 years ago, a little less than 2 years ago, and she bought a space in East Hampton, and she wanted to transform that space into a spa. She wanted a luxurious spa, and she had that very clear vision that she wanted something natural, with a touch of, she's a big fan of argan oil, so that's why the name is Arganic. So she wanted something outdoorsy and ultra luxurious. So I'm going to show you two products. They are over there. So you can have a look, of course. And so the spa in East Hampton is not finished. It's still on construction. But in the meantime, she was able to sell the product and to sign a deal, an exclusive distribution with the Ritz-Carlton in New York City. So the retail price is $495. And again, she wanted something ultra luxurious. So that's what it is. And we did also the candle. So this is the candle with the gold-plated top. So it retails at $375. So we work with Ralf. And as I said earlier, so what I did is that, of course, I have to make sure that the customer is serious, because I don't want to waste the precious time and talent of Ralf. So I have to make sure that, you know, the customer really have a very clear vision, that this is really willing, that we get a deposit, of course. And from that point, we sit down with Ralf in his office in New York. So Ralf, can you tell us a little how, for instance, that process was?
You know, most of the time I spent working with big houses. You know, François already mentioned that most fragrance brands are owned by big companies like L'Oreal, Procter & Gamble, Estée Lauder. So for a perfumer, it's always a welcome opportunity to just meet somebody and try to, you know, put his or her vision into scent. That's exactly what I do. You know, my job is, you know, it's a little bit between craft. You know, that's you know, his company is called Crafting Beauty. You know, but I think perfumery is really a craft, and a little bit of art as well, and design. So I think it's mostly design, in fact. So when somebody comes, and Laurie here from Organic Beauté, she talks about her vision. You know, she wanted something outdoorsy, but I think most important is in this case here, you mentioned that French champagne and some liqueurs, you know. So that's, I think, the fragrance, if you smell it, you know, has more to do with that. You know, it's a blend of fruit notes, you know, on a woody floral base. So in this case, you know, she mentioned those.
Actually, it was interesting because she came to the office and, you know, some people might bring some scent and everything. No, she brought a small bottle of Chambord. She brought a small bottle of Fragola liqueur from Italy. And then there was a few scent that she did some research. And she said, you know, Ralf, can you put all of this together? But I really want to have a note of those smells. And that's where your art comes into place.
Yeah, of course. You know, we have all these materials to play with. You know, because in fact, what I do is really very playful. You know, that's what I still like about it. You know, I like it often to cooking. You know, you know the notes you use. You know, the spices especially. You know, we have all those spices at hand. We can use cardamom, curries, coriander, anything. You know, this is all on our palate. For the fruit notes, it's a little bit more difficult. You know, because but here at Man, we have in fact a great collection of extracts of fruit. You know, so for example, in Laurie's fragrance, you know, there is a cassis, like a blackcurrant extract, which I haven't never really smelled elsewhere. So we put a big dose of that, you know, some cherries, and of course the Chambord, which is more, based on raspberry. So, you know, it's a very fruity cocktail, you know, and you know, and for this project, you know, there she, you know, as she wanted to launch it at the Ritz-Carlton, so her price point is quite high. You can imagine the point of investment, the return on investment. So you know, that's of course great for me to play with, you know, because for these more commercial products, you know, like these big mass products, you know, we have much less price to play with, you know. And that's really sometimes quite sad, you know. You want to indulge, and you can't really. But here we could.
Yes, you have a good point, and I will say the parallel is that yes, of course, you know. I mean, you know, Ralf, he did, for instance, Giorgio Armani. He did really some major
collaborations.
You know? He did some major, but because it's a license of L'Oréal. When L'Oréal comes to a house of man, they are very strict in terms of budget. It's like, okay, we want a scent that way, but also don't go over that budget. So it's a little bit like a designer that will, I will say, create a line for Macy's, and then all of a sudden, you know, Bergdorf Goodman comes to them and say, you know what, you can do whatever, use the fabric you want, use the most beautiful silk or most beautiful lace. So I guess for you, it's also a sort of builder, you know, it's like, ah, I can be a little more creative, because in a case like L'Arganic, and most of my customer, you know, with Crafting Beauty, is that there's no budget. It's like, you know, the point is that we want to accomplish what the scent they are wishing for. Am I right?
Yeah, perfectly. But one other point is, you know, in this case, we really have to only please the client. You know, she had her own vision. You know, she was really one person who decides. And, you know, we saw each other several times. You know, I saw her. She came back 3 weeks later. I proposed a couple of ideas, you know, then we let it sit for a couple of weeks, you know, because that's quite important with product development. You know, if you smell something for the first time, or, you know, with my analogy to cooking, you know, you smell, you know, eat somewhere in Asia, you know, one dish, you know, and you might find it interesting, but it's not quite easy perhaps to get, you know. So I think with cooking and with fragrance it's the same, you know, you find... you might smell something interesting, but, you know, not quite understood or quite pleasing, really, you know. So it's always good to come back to it and to smell it perhaps a couple of weeks later, because then all of a sudden you might think, oh yeah, I smelled that and I really am liking it again, you know. And so that's important. So this whole process took a couple of months, you know, and as François said, you know, that's great to have, you know, up to a year for those kind of projects would be great, but we can do it as well in only perhaps 6 months.
So Ralf, you brought some, can you tell us, we will pass around, can you tell more about what you brought?
Yeah, you know, I thought, you know, we have to smell at least something here. you know, you can smell the finished products, you know, on the table, but I just wanted to show you a little bit more how I do it, you know. So these are all, let's just, you know, let's start with this one here, you know. This is just, you know, these are really simple notes, you know. These are not oils, but just simple building blocks. So the first one, no, this one. Yeah. This, you know, first one you will certainly recognize, I guess. Yeah, perhaps a little bit less, you know, because you just shake it. Well, you know, let me do it. You know, like I'll show you.
No. Okay.
What do you say?
Notes? No. Oh, those notes. Yeah, okay. He's gonna. Okay.
Yeah, just look at that, you know.
Okay.
And you can just distribute it already. You just dip them in. You know, the first one, you know, that's for each person one, you know. I don't know, it might not be enough for everybody, but I brought 40 or so. So this is, you know, it's mentioned as well what it is, you know. This is vanillin, you know, and vanillin is, you know, we talked about cooking, you know, you know that smell, you know. This is what is, you know, the main ingredient or the main odor ingredient in vanilla, or in, you know, in all kinds of candy and so on. So, and vanilla has been used in perfumery for a long time already. You know, just distribute everything. Well, yeah. yeah. Vanilla is really. Yeah, please.
When you create a special edition perfume, what guarantee does the customer have that that limited edition is not going to be produced again for someone else at a later date?
Yeah, but that's easy to answer. You know, we of course wouldn't do it. You know, there's a contract, but you know, with perfume, it's there's no patent on it. You know, there's and now we have quite sophisticated analytical means. So if you have a perfume and to go to company and tell them, you know, I would like something which is close to that, it's really quite easy. You know, they just put it into a like a machine. You know, it's analytical chemistry, basic analytical chemistry. You know, they know how to do that nowadays. It's called gas chromatography coupled with mass spectrometry, and they've separate the mixture, which is a perfume, and you can even analyze the ingredients and then recreate it. It's rarely 100% the same, but you know, you can easily go to 90%. But so that's as well the reason you find on the market so many perfumes which are close to the others, you know. So that's just the part of the game. So you just have to try to be really relevant and original. And I think in that case, you know, if somebody else copies you, you know, it would just be quite blatant, you know. But back to our thing here, you know. So you saw vanillin. You know, I don't know. Perhaps not everybody has the blotter. But you know, for vanillin is just a very basic ingredient, and it was. So you can dip this one. Yeah, the top. You know, the only the top. The point has some fragrance on it. So this is quite diluted. It's a 5% solution of vanillin in alcohol. So it's not a big, not, it's not very strong, but it's sufficient, I guess. So these vanillin, yeah, just a moment. Vanillin is used in oriental fragrances, you know, like opium and so on, you know, it's a slush of vanillin or shalimar. It's a very, very classic product. So the next one is something more contemporary. It's called, you know, these are chemical names, you know, this is called ethyl maltol. So, you know, this you already, perhaps you might not really know what that could smell like. So I'll let you guess. And there were some questions here. Yeah, vanillin is not regular, it's not really vanilla. You know, vanilla, I of course could have shown you that as well, but vanilla is quite a complex mixture. You know, vanilla is the part of an orchid. So there are quite a lot of animalic products, for example. You know, if you smell a real vanilla bean, it's not so nice. You know, there are almost leathery aspects to it. But vanillin is just the main ingredient. You know, have you ever seen a vanilla pod which has crystals on it? You know, that is vanillin, in fact. You know, I remember I went once to Madagascar, and they have these high-priced vanilla pods. And then they're crystallized because they're so fragrant. So this is not the big mix, the real mixture, but it's only one ingredient of the mixture. You know, I just wanted to make it simple. You know, these are chemical. You know, like just basic chemicals. You know, but what we do. To play with, you know, we not only use natural ingredients, but we use a lot of synthetically derived ingredients, you know, but vanilla or vanillin is found in vanilla and is nature identical. But it's not processed through vanilla, because that would be very expensive. You know, as you know, vanilla pods are outrageously expensive. So if we did vanilla through that, you know, it would be really too expensive. No, let's do that first. You know, so you have these two. You have ethyl maltol and vanilla. So ethyl maltol is in fact something I like to. It smells a little bit like sugar. I don't know whether you agree. And you know, if you combine these two together, you know, vanilla and you know, just hold these two blotters, or you know, we call that a blotter, together, and you might think of what's this called again? You know, Baba Papa is in English. Cotton candy. Yeah, you know, because that is you know, sugar is. What it is, and then it's often flavored, and often it's done with vanilla.
Now for perfumes. Now that ambergris is no longer used, what are you using as a fixative for the perfumes?
You know, this is already quite technical, what you ask, you know. Lady asked what I use nowadays, or what we use nowadays without ambergris as a fixative. You know, ambergris is a product emanated from the sperm whales. You know, perhaps you have read about those stories. You know, some product is floating on the oceans, and you find it on the beaches. That is ambergris. You know, it's ejected, in fact, through the at least I think through the mouth of the whale, not the other way. It's a kind of ugly mask, like a grayish. It's solidified. You know, it's solid, but it's even solidifies over the time, and it doesn't smell very good first, but it's because it has to float on the oceans. You know, so you need the sun. To metabolize the products which are in ambergris, and you find it on the oceans, and it looks like a stone or so, you know. So many, you know, there are people who are really looking for ambergris still, because it's still used in some parts of the world, especially in Asian or in Arabian perfumery. But you might not even find it if you're walking on the beach, and you could even find it here on Long Island, you know, because there are still sperm whales around. Anyway, this ambergris was used in fine fragrances and perfumes as a fixative, as the lady says. You know, but a fixative, I don't really believe in the idea of a fixative. You know, fixative would mean it's something there to fix the other ingredients of the perfume. You know, so something which fixes it on the skin or something like that. But that doesn't really work like that, you know, because the ingredients we have, some are very volatile, some, you know, if I dip it, you know, and I hand it to you, it's already gone, you know, so, you know, something like, or alcohol even, alcohol has a little smell as well, or ethyl acetate, you know, those kind of things, you know, they evaporate and you don't smell them afterwards. But then there are scents, you know, which stay for forever. So ambergris is, you know, you have synthetic equivalents, you know, which smell a little bit like ambergris, you know, done in the, you can dip the lid, yeah. You know, there is something like called ambroxan, for example, which is smells or which has one part of the odor profile of ambergris. So this was. You know, there was done a lot of research in the 60s and 70s, you know, when the chemist, you know, really looked into natural products, you know, rose, ambergris, anything, jasmine, and they found many, you know, they through structure elucidation, you know, they found many interesting molecules which we now have in our palate, you know, which could be synthesized later on.
Ralf, what brought you to this trade? How did you start doing what you do?
Yeah, that's a typical but good question, I guess. You know, I hear that question often, you know, when people, you know, because perfumers, you know, it's quite a rare profession. Here in New York, you know, we are quite a lot, you know, but it's really mostly Paris, New York, Sao Paulo, for example. You wouldn't find a lot of perfumers in Philadelphia or London or so. You know, I was trained as a chemist, but that's just my way of doing it. You know, I thought of doing art school after school, but I think I was a little bit too afraid or so. I was always interested in chemistry and natural sciences, so that's what I did. After school, but I was never really quite satisfied. You know, and through a friend, you know, I got to know a little bit more about that this profession. And I specialized in fragrance chemistry. So there are chemists who are really, interested in how to understand and to elucidate structures, you know, found in nature. And then I applied for that formation, you know, and the formation of a perfumer is mostly done in those companies I now work for, because there are very few independent perfumers. So I got my training with them. This took like 3 years, more or less, or you know, even a little bit longer, because you have to learn all these ingredients I'm just showing you, which is now the last one you showed. This was allyl heptanoate. So what did you think? That smells like what? Apple? Pineapple. Yeah. I think as well, it smells really like pineapple. Let's do this one. And you know, you could just now put the pineapple, so the allyl heptanoate, with that sugar molecule or with that vanilla. So you can, you know, you can already perhaps find a different aspect of it, you know, because there are, I think if you put the sugar plus the pineapple, it really smells like pineapple, because you know I like the ripe pineapple. You know, you have green pineapple, but you have as well the really ripe one. So, ça va? So there's another one coming. So in fact, that's a little bit how we do this. You know, we have in our palette, you know, we have like 1,000, 2,000 materials like that. So I had to. To learn all those during my formation. You know, you can't learn them by heart, you know, so easily. So perhaps you learn 100 or 200 quite well. And then you try to learn the other remaining 800 or 1500, you know, a little bit later. But afterwards you can really put them into families. You know, of course you have the fruits, you have the woods, you have the florals, you have the citrus notes. So it makes it already a bit easier to put them into brackets. So next one, that should be as well relatively easy to smell. I don't know. Do you, somebody? No? Pomme? Yeah? I don't think so. Nobody?
So what do you smell, the third one? No, the fourth one.
No, this is hexan oil. It's hexan oil. Yeah. You dip this one, no?
No, I dip this one.
Yeah, you dip this one, yeah.
Yeah.
No, no idea?
We have a winner.
Yeah, but what do you think? You know, do you smell that that last material? Pear?
Pear.
Yeah, right. I think it smells like pear. Somebody said garlic. Yeah, but you know, everything is, you know, nothing is wrong really, you know, because each has a different perception. So you can now put that one here. Yeah. I think this smells quite nicely like pear, or like especially like Bartlett pear, my favorite. But no, it's, I find it's more like Bartlett pear, but Bartlett pear, yeah, which is easy to get here. You had a question?
Possible to make fragrance or perfume without formaldehyde? Without formaldehyde? Formaldehyde?
Yes. Formaldehyde. Yeah, formaldehyde is not a fragrance ingredient, you know. This is this has a smell, but you know, first it's toxic and we don't use this. Formaldehyde is often a metabolic product, you know. If you heat it too much or so, you know, formaldehyde might form, because it's it formates the esters of formic acid. It's not really used so much in perfume, so you know it's not used in what we do, you know. Yeah, no formaldehyde.
Okay. I have a question for Francois. So how you marry the client with the nose, whether it be Ralph or Christophe.
I put them together, yes. I'm not
right.
Really marrying them.
Well, you know, not exactly, but in a way, it's a marriage, just as fragrances are a marriage of sorts. I mean, usually it's not one note, it's several notes, right? So, okay. So it's a marriage. Now, how do you select? I mean, is it the person, okay, so this lady's really rich and she's going to sell a very expensive fragrance. I think that it's going to go to Ralph. And someone with a smaller budget, do you go by budget? You know, how do you do that?
You have a very good point. So how do I put the perfumer with the customer? I have a very good relationship with the House of Man and with Ralph. So it comes as a top priority. It really depends. If I can also present some project to the House of Man, and they might say, you know what, François, it's not really for us, you know, you might as well go to, you know. So it really depends. But because my minimum is low, my unit cost anyway is high. I mean, let's face it. So I am not gonna, I mean, yes, sometimes I have some requests of people that want a perfume that they don't want the actual barrel, I mean, the finished product not to go over $5, for instance. And we are talking 100,000 or 50,000 different units. I'm not really geared to that. I'm luxury, I'm couture, it says couture fragrance creation. So I will send them to somebody else and then, you know, but that's what it is, you know. Thank you. So the last one. Alors, yeah, let's pass the last one.
Okay, that's only the last one, you know, and this is...
Your nose will relax. After.
Yeah,
that's the question over there.
Yeah, this is just something, you know, because that's quite different because this is called hexanol. I don't know. I'll let you smell it first. I'll let you smell it, and perhaps you know there's somebody else who wants to have a question. And I talked about that hexanol just in a minute.
Does a nose have to have a chemistry degree, or is it beneficial at all to have a chemistry degree?
No, I don't think so. You know, that was just my way of approaching this trade, but and certainly I have a different approach. You know, because I when I smell a fragrance or when I read a chemical name, that brings a different image for me, but. No, you know, we just use it as colors, as pigments, you know. There's no really necessity to know that it's an aldehyde or ketone or something. Because, you know, a fragrance is a mixture, you know. There's no chemical reaction, really, you know. It's just a physical mixture of different chemicals. But they don't react with each other, you know, so...
Well, I'm sorry.
You know, the hexanol, perhaps, you know? The blood of Eve. Oh, you wanted to say something about that?
No, that's good.
Yeah. Yeah, just the hexanol is this fragrance you smell now. Just, you know, if somebody has an idea how that smells like? Grass, yeah. Yes. I think that's, you know, hexanol is a molecule found in all all vegetables, you know, so it's as well in nature identical. And, you know, if again, if you have that pineapple, for example, or the pineapple and the sugar and then the grass, you know, you just smells perhaps a little bit more like unripe, pineapple.
Yeah, and as you can see, the grass is very popular lately because specifically in America, and I'm sure Ralf can tell me the same thing, people are always looking for a fresh scent. And that touch of grass always gives a sort of freshness. Anyway, so we're going to continue with questions of answer after, but Victoria wants to say something, or I don't know what's up. Anyway, thank you very much.
Francois and Ralf, and thank you for your exquisite presentation, and we've learned so much, and we're excited to sample what's on the table there. And you put so much into this lecture. I have to say, Francois, with every single detail, including the window outside, if you go to the right, it looked beautiful. Yes, thank you. And he also cared so much about attendance. I have to say, you know, he was so concerned that we're a nonprofit, and you were very caring about that. And then, well, the champagne that you'd sent over this morning, it was just too much. And then little treats for us. It kept coming. With every email, it grew and it grew. So on behalf of the General Society of Mechanics and Tradesmen, we express our gratitude to François Damide, founder and president of Crafting Beauty, Artisan perfume producer. Congratulations. Thank you. And thank you. And we also want to congratulate you on your fifth anniversary to many, many, many more years of success. So thank you so much there.